So we have the last speaker, Professor Desi Raju. Can we have Professor Desi Raju on the screen, please?
Yes, can you hear me, please?
Sir Pranam, Janeshwar, sir.
Oh, very good. Very good. So
Pranam,
you see.
Pranam, sir.
Pranam, Pranam. See, it's a great pleasure to be with all of you. And Professor Sastrabuddhe said that, you know, God is willing to see you, but the Dwarpalak is not agreeing. So this is what was happening to me till now. But you can hear me properly, right?
Yes, sir.
Very good. See, I'd like to, and also in the process, Professor Khandal has become the moderator and I have become the speaker. So very nice. Now, that's the way, because we teachers have to learn to improvise under any situation, whether on e-learning or whether in regular classroom. Now, you see, I have been listening very closely to the four lectures so far. Professor Agarwal and Professor Sahasrabuddhe talked about the formalities and how we proceed with the given set of rules and how we can manage in the post-COVID scenario. Professor Sharma went into more general issues about the purpose of education. I am glad that Professor Shevgankar said that some of the problems are not engineering specific, although some of them are. So in the brief 5 to 7 minutes that I have, see, firstly, I'm the only one who is not an engineer in this group. So I'm looking at it from outside, but I've been a teacher for 40 years. So first thing is, and things on which we are all in agreement, a blend of e-learning and conventional learning, all that is fine. The business of a higher value system, what education should be all about, and the fact that we seem to have lost sight of the basic moorings, I think this is a real challenge today. And the present system of education, whether in engineering or whether in chemistry or basic sciences, we seem to have lost that completely. Partly this is, I think, because of the terrific economic insecurity that our people face. I've had the privilege of looking at the questions from a number of participants. There is anxiety and even panic among the students and the teachers as to what is really going to happen. I definitely agree that COVID should be turned into a big opportunity. You know, Prime Minister said, I think in one of his TV addresses to the nation, he spoke about quantum jump. Whereas we in India, with apologies to Professor Sahasrabuddhe, we have to come out of this culture of consensus thinking, incremental innovations, and very, very guarded comments and very small incremental. Somewhere we have to think out of the box. We have to be able to make big jumps, and this kind of thing will not necessarily please everyone. I mean, Professor Sahasrabuddhe did say that some of the things he said will not please everyone. I think that's very good. I think when you start doing things that don't please everyone, then you are on the right track. And I think we have to be more comfortable. I mean all of us Indians have to be more comfortable about out of the box innovative thinking. We must get out of this consensus mindset. This committee system has failed us completely. Let me say that I've sat on so many committees. What happens in many of these decisions is just the lowest common denominator is agreed upon. And this is not enough for India today. India is an aspiring country. Our young people are both idealistic as well as innocent. And I think they deserve a better deal from people in our generation. And let us say even the generation below us, the people who are in their 50s and so on, how on earth we are going to get this kind of a thinking difference? You know, it is a question of changing one's whole mentality and mindset. I think this is, Professor Khandal has called it reboot. Yes, reboot, actually throw away the old computer and get a new computer, which is what I did in order to come and be heard by all of you. So we need to be able to innovate in that sense. Revolutionary, radical ways is what we need to change. Now, how? So so that you don't accuse me of just speaking, you know, vague, airy, fairy things. Let me say a couple of things which have to be done at the bureaucratic, yes, maybe, but at the political level. The first thing is there needs to be more uniformity in some of our syllabuses. In fact, a lady, Dr. Abha Vasisht, Associate Professor IMS Ghaziabad, has this question, common curriculum at university level. I think this is a must. And because we have so many different kinds of syllabuses, not only in science, but also in engineering. And we need some amount of order and discipline in this syllabus, first. Second, this is very contentious and it has to be done at the highest political level. Whether education itself should be in the central list, the concurrent list, or the state list. Now, this is such a big kind of a step. And I think many of our problems today, excuse me, ladies and gentlemen, if I have offended any of you, many of our problems today occur because education is in the concurrent list. Either it goes completely into the state list or it should go completely into the central list, because this concurrent list is pleasing nobody. It is because of this that so many, you know, changes are going on. We don't know, a college in UP doesn't know what a college in Tamil Nadu is doing. And yes, I do agree that we trained too many engineers 20 years ago, especially in the southern states. I don't think many of you have an idea about the number of crazy engineering colleges that had come up, you know, and the fact that many of these are closing down now. And Professor Sarasvati also confessed correctly that they are not even within the control of AICTE and so on. So there must be something here. This is also connected to the money problem in private universities. This business of public sector, private sector difference must go. Professor Kandal said the private sector people should be involved in decision making. But I tell you, they should be involved at all levels. Before long, you know, we must get to a stage where we can hardly distinguish between private sector and public sector. This kind of rigid demarcation between these two is really not good. And it is not good for education. It may be good for, I mean, let me put it this way. Defense, external affairs, finance are all considered only in the central list. I think education and health are as important. And right now, health is in the state list and education is in the concurrent list. I don't think that we can do the necessary changes out of the box thinking unless at a very basic level we start looking at the roles of these departments. Because whatever we may do, whatever we may talk, webinars, even AICTE, UGC, they are all under, you know, ultimate constitutional things. These must be looked at, Professor Kandal and all the other panelists. This must be done. And finally, last, most, you know, esoteric point, which I know is close, dear to the heart of both Professor Sharma and Professor Kandal. And we've talked about it and some of the questions also were on this. Should we change over into a Vedic system? Now, this is, again, a revolutionary idea. It will take a very long time. It will take 70 years, 75 years. But I think discussion on this must start in the HRD. And yes, HRD also better get its act right. It took 6 years for them and they still haven't come out with the National Education Policy. Now, this is, sounds very strange to many of us. And I think we need to start thinking, at least in HRD, about Vedic system. If we are going to get into the Vedic system, how do we do it? In the short term, you can't do it because right now we are in the American system. So we have to have a plan for the short term, the medium term, and the long term. And students have asked this about the Vedic system. And somebody else has said students are very savvy today. They are extremely savvy. They are much savvier than us. And I think we should lose the fear about change. Indians are most scared about change. And we have to lose this fear so that we may take education not only in the short run to give people jobs and stuff like that, make the state universities more powerful, make the private universities more powerful, treat private and public as one and the same, and then think about major constitutional changes which alone can change the face of education in this country. Professor Kandal, I think I have spoken enough.
Thank you, sir. You have spoken not enough, but you have spoken real, real points you have touched upon. you are known for speaking frank and speaking upfront.